back of the room.
It's all yours.
Okay, well, thank you, Mr. Chair and council folks who showed up. I haven't been the director for very long, so I went through this education process, and I'm still learning on what it means for the city's code adoption process. And so kind of felt like it was a good opportunity, since we will be having a couple of the codes come before you guys in a number of weeks, to go over the process at least. And then there'll be a few items as an example of what changes with some of the upcoming codes. So with that. All right, so code adoption process. This, like I said, is small. I thought this could be a bigger monitor. Anyways, the first step is there are some national code publishers out there that put out a set of codes that most all municipalities use. And this next slide is kind of a series of codes that the city of Lincoln adopts. If you look there, most of them come from the international series of codes. You got the International Building Code, which is the commercial code, International Residential Code. That's our residential housing, one and two family dwelling code. A Uniform Plumbing Code, that's the other publication that is sometimes used. Our plumbing industry has chosen to stick with it over the international codes due to additional detail reasons. Then there's the National Electrical Code. That is adopted by everybody. It's adopted by the state and the municipalities who adopt their own code are required to adopt it as well. And I guess I should say the same is true for any code that the state officially adopts. There's a state building code. There is not a state mechanical code. There's not a state plumbing code, but there is a state building code and a state electrical code. And we have to substantially follow suit with both of those codes. International Fire Code, then the Mechanical Code, International Fuel Gas Code, Property Maintenance Code, and then to round things out is the 1994 edition of the Uniform Abatement of Dangerous Building Codes. I have not had to use that since I've been in my position, but it does exist, and we can have it available to anybody who's really curious. If you look at the dates there, those are the dates of the versions that we currently have adopted. The 2009, mostly, the electrical code is on a different cycle than the other codes. They still publish every 3 years. A lot of municipalities kind of are on their own schedule as far as adopting. Generally, Lincoln has chosen to adopt a new version as it comes out. For the most part, there was a couple of years back in the early 2000s. I think we skipped the 2006 version. We went straight from 2003 to the 2009. But for the most part, we choose to stay on a fairly regular schedule every 3 years. We don't rush out and adopt the codes the immediately when they're published. It's a lengthy review process. Plus, some of them go through rather numerous reprintings. For example, the mechanical code is on its fifth printing, and so it gives it the chance to flush out some of the errors that may have been published with the earlier ones. It also gives our staff and our industry groups a chance to talk with their peers across the country and look at what code areas or changes to the code didn't pan out so well in practice. And so that's why it looks like we're behind the eight ball a little bit here, but we're actually pretty much right on where we want to be historically. So that's the international publications. The next step, building and safety takes this stack of codes as they come up, and essentially goes through it pretty thoroughly, word for word. What we do also get is an additional publication to the actual code that focuses on the differences between them. It's a lot smaller book, so we focus on those changes to see if we agree with what's changed from one edition to the other, and then then decide whether or not to make those recommendations moving forward. It is a lengthy internal process. It'll probably take, I don't know, two to three months for our staff to review it thoroughly, you know, keeping up with their other work that they're responsible for as well. So that does take a while. But we do try and get that review started pretty quickly when they, as the codes come out. So we'll turn that around. Like I said, we'll make recommendations to what we call the Code Review Task Force. And there's a Code Review Task Force for pretty much each one of the codes. Some of the task forces are responsible for multiple codes. I guess the Mechanical Task Force covers the review of the Mechanical Code and the Fuel Gas Code. Plumbing Task Force does the Plumbing Code. It also does the Fire Sprinkler Code, so on. Task Force, they're composed of contractors and design professionals like architects, engineers. They have particular knowledge, experience, and expertise in these fields. For example, the Plumbing Code Task Force is a pretty mixed bag of mechanical engineers and then local plumbing contractors that, one, have good standing in the community. Our staff has a good knowledge of what contractors they see issues with as far as code compliance, what don't, and that conduct, you know, business in a good way. And so most of the time it's those contractors that are recommended for appointment to these task forces. So those groups, they have the knowledge, and the other main requirement is that they're willing to put the time in. Not everybody is. It's hard to find sometimes these folks who are willing to put in the two to eight months that it takes sometimes for them to go through their codes, because not only do they have to go through the published codes, then they also go through the Lincoln Municipal codes that correspond to those published codes. So those are the two main requirements for appointment to that task force. Oops. So from that task force, we go to the code study committee. So with this, there we go. That's what I want to get back to. All of the actions at the task force level, they are required to go through kind of a modified Robert's Rules of Conduct. They make motions. They take seconds. They elect a chair. All of the motions and actions and then votes are recorded by building and safety staff. We also record the meetings to have on hand digitally, to have on hand to go back and listen to individual discussions if we need to pull those back up as we're trying to compile the list of recommendations that they make. So we take that recommendation, and then oftentimes in between the task force completion, city staff compiles it, and if there's certain items or recommendations that came out of that task force process, we'll brief different folks, usually the mayor. We'll brief him on some of the items that might come out of there that he has expressed interest in previously, or that we feel need to have his knowledge of moving forward. No decisions are made at that point. It's just kind of a information giving. And I will say that the task force process for these current codes happened before I was here, so I have not actually gone through the task force process. I may make a few changes to the way they did it the next time, so that it's easier for whoever my predecessor might be to follow, because it's been a challenge. So from the task force, and then after we have compiled all their recommendations, maybe briefed the mayor, or maybe even consulted some other outside experts, vendors, or other industry professionals, we take the group of codes, or the group of recommendations it's called the Code Study Committee. It's another citizen group that it is made up of, 50% of some of the task force members, various task force members. So there may be one or two from the Building Code Task Force, or one or two from the Plumbing Code Task Force, so on. so forth. And then the other half of that committee are at-large positions. They're not directly associated with the injury, to get some, opinion or input from a consumer standpoint from these codes. Now, the reason we feel that is okay at this standpoint is the Code Study Committee's main responsibility is not to go through these books again. They're not supposed to go through each one of the changes. They don't go through the Lincoln Municipal Code line by line. What they do is basically take a list that we prepare for them of the recommendations and changes that the task force recommended. And then this group is just kind of another layer of review over that previous group's decisions and recommendations. And so, like I said, the other half of the Code Study Committee is at-large folk. There's accountants, there's university professors, there's stay-at-home moms, there's a wide range of folks that make up that committee. There again, they operate on a majority vote kind of rule. And building safety records all motions and takes notes and compiles the responses. From the Code Study Committee, then after that's done, we compile the final list of recommendations that have come out of the public process to date for the codes. We put it into a spreadsheet similar to this that has some pieces of information, and anybody's welcome to take a look at it. It's got a brief description of the changes themselves, the codes that are affected, some justification for the changes, and even if there happened to be a cost change associated with it, if maybe it's an increase in cost to the developer or the builder or the homeowner, or whatever, or maybe there's an additional cost that the city would incur due to the changes. There's an additional inspection that we may have to make or something like that. That's kind of accounted for on there. We take that and do a presentation to the mayor with that set of information and get a really, it's a lot more in-depth discussion than any of the other briefings that we have with other officials. And then from there, he may decide which sets or which recommendations he wants to move forward. In my experience, there hasn't been any changes made. We did the presentation and we moved forward with the recommendations from the Code Study Committee. So from there, once that part is done, we will internally create sort of a underline and strike through version of the code for the law department to create an ordinance for. And that's sometimes a little bit lengthy process because sometimes the organization and the quality of information that they receive is varying, it has been over the past. So we're going to try and clean that up to streamline that process for them. I think we got a couple other codes that will be coming before you in the next couple of months that we changed the process a little bit to more easily get the information to those folks. So once the law department has that draft ordinance, we get to review it again. We're okay with it. Then we send it forward for you all to look at and public hearing and adoption. So I guess that's kind of the process that we go through for code adoption. And so I don't know, at this point, I got a couple more slides that talk about some of the specific codes that we'll be looking at, but are there any questions regarding the process so far, maybe suggestions?
Well, I'm just curious how often the product changes when it goes from task force to committee and then on to mayor, like how often the committee actually diverges from what the task force recommends.
Sure. I've only got one experience to pull from. I guess maybe I ask my staff the same thing. So I'll start there. In years past, there has not been a lot of changes from the task force. It has been you know, the task force process. It'll move through. There will be lively discussion at the code study committee, and usually that involves the task force members there, and then maybe they'll pull in a couple of other task force members for discussion, or maybe even a couple of other experts to talk about. But ultimately, in previous experiences, it hasn't changed much. In this case, there was a few changes between code study and task force that actually didn't end up mattering at the code study level. Okay, at the task force level, the recommendation was to adopt the 2012 versions of the energy code related chapters from the building code. That came out of the task force. There were some amendments to that code, quite a few amendments to that code. It took a lot of the task force recommended a lot of deletions from the 2012 code, but they were recommending to adopt the 2012 version. At the code study committee level, there was a lot of discussion about what that 2012 energy code did, what, you know, they didn't know for sure how it was going to affect homeowner or the home building industry. So the code study committee actually ended up voting to not move forward with that 2012 version. They decided to just say, well, let's just do whatever the state does, essentially the 2009 version. And so that was the main change that came from code study committee, from the task force, in my experience this year. There were a couple of other minor changes where some of the code study committee members thought things needed to be worded different, but there was no other material changes made between task force and code study committee. The code study committee also, before they agreed to not approve the 2012 energy code at all, the code study committee had already approved the deletion of some of the other energy code related items, like commissioning for commercial buildings or blower door test for residential, some additional insulation requirements that was a change from the 09 to the 12. Neither group approved those changes. A couple of other small items, but those are the only changes.
Do folks from LES get involved in the energy code discussions? Are they?
They, from what I gather from the minutes from those task force meetings, they had some representatives from LES show up and do some discussions. At the code study committee, which was the first time I was involved, they did not come and give a technical presentation. That was done at the task force level.
How important is it to be current on the code recommendations? I mean, are there a lot of cities that are 3 to 6 years behind the current standards?
Yes.
Can you talk about that a
little? I would say, when you say a lot, I wouldn't say the majority, but more than I would have expected before I started looking into it. I would say Lincoln's probably on the leading edge of being up to date. I hate making comparisons to Omaha, but I think they were either in the 2003 or 2006 version still, where we were in the 2009. I think there's maybe it's North Platte that's still in the 2000 version. And technically speaking, the way we interpret the state statutes, that's a no-no. But nationally, I would say the majority, or more than half, stay up to date with the codes as they come out. In regard to specific codes, if they pick and choose different editions of each code, I don't know. We could certainly look into that. The ICC website has a unique feature where you can click on there to see who all at least has reported adopting their codes.
I would guess that part of the difficulty in accepting changes and recommendations is potential cost implications. Do you ever have financial folks on the committee that can help assess what the costs of various items are, or where do you get that kind of information to put it in reality in terms of dollars?
Well, the way the EO is written, these committees are created by the executive order process. I should have mentioned that. So the way the executive order is written, they have those committees they can call whoever they want to the group to have discussions. from what I could gather this time, all of the financial information that was gathered by members of the group. You know, contractors, staff put together some of the information, but from what I think maybe you're asking from a kind of like a life cycle kind of or a big picture financial implication, I don't know that there was a lot of input, at least during this process.
Right. A couple questions. Sure. One is, at what point do people in the general public who may have interest in these things discover what's going on, what the recommendations might be? Is it the same time the council sees it, or is it before that?
Well, each one of these meetings are a public meeting.
Okay.
We notice them on, at least when I started, we noticed it on, we put notice on the website. We also post notice down here in the display. So they're all public meetings, so we put that information out there. We don't do a press release or anything like that to really get it out there, but we advertise on, you know, the locations at our website where, you know, at least contractor type folk would be looking. We could certainly expand that. The only, we really don't want to turn the task force meetings into real broad-reaching public hearing, but they are public meetings, so people can show up. Now, the chair, just like any other setting, the chair would have to be willing to accept testimony or whatever discussion from those folk.
Okay.
And certainly, if we are contacted by an individual who does have interest, the more specific, the better, as far as topic. Because then we could actually make that an agenda item for discussion at the task force meetings.
So these national construction code publications, who comes up with those? Where are they? Yeah, where's this coming from?
Well, the international. Now I'll explain what I know of the process, and each one of these has an organization. There is some history between the code publications. There was a uniform code council that split into two or whatever, and it became the International Code Council a number of years ago, and there was all that. But basically, these two main publications, the International Code Council, they're called the I-Codes, and then there's the Uniform Codes, and I think the actual acronym is International Association of Plumbing and Mechanical Officials. There we go, IATMO. Those are the two main public publishers of codes. They have national boards that with conventions that meet and have public hearings and conduct all kinds of research on their own to come up with what to put in the codes. Lincoln has had a presence at these national codes over the years at the ICC convention, and we actually have our chief plumbing inspector has been, the previous inspector has been the president of IATMO before, and the current chief, is also heavily involved, and I think he may end up president as well. So we're kind of plugged into those processes. I wouldn't say that we have a direct influence in what happens at those codes,
okay,
or at those conferences.
There's another question then about, you know, you mentioned the state codes. Mm-hmm. What is the relationship between the state codes and our municipal codes?
The state statute gives municipalities the ability to make amendments to the state code. I think it's, I'll paraphrase here, but it's something like, so long as it is substantially the same. Some reasons for, I would let Jeff maybe, if he wants to expand on that, but they give some reasons for amending the code, making changes locally. Some of them are cost savings, some of them are safety related if there are local conditions or efficiency, energy efficiency. There is kind of a list of reasons that the statute allows for local municipalities to make.
So is the state passing these codes first? and then we receive them? Or are they just saying you have the right to make changes to these within a certain limitations?
The way it has worked in the past, we have been ahead of the state, typically. I want to say because the state was on the 06 version longer than we were. I'd probably have to look into some to some of that history, Roy. I don't know all that, but in this case, the state statute, the way it currently exists, says that a municipality has 2 years to adopt the state building code. If there is no state code, like the mechanical code, we're free to adopt any code we want. We can make up our own code. In fact, Omaha does that for plumbing. Omaha does not adopt a published code at all. They created their own code. So, if there is a state code, usually there's requirements as to when the municipality who chooses to do their own code. If a municipality is small enough, like a village or whatever, and they don't have a larger government subdivision like a Lincoln to help out with their code adoption, then they would automatically fall into the state code. And the state makes no amendments to the published codes. Okay, I'll rephrase. They don't make very many. The only change that the state made to the building code recently was they deleted the 2012 chapters of the energy code, and so we were, well, anybody who adopts it, at least according to our interpretation, would then have to adopt those 2009 chapters.
Cindy? You mentioned that when it comes to building and safety, the codes, mm-hmm. and then goes on to the code review task force, that they're having to review the entire book, so to speak. But so I wondered, is there a an underlined and strike-through copy of summary that you get before we have to digest it?
Sure, I think you missed that. Yeah, we can choose to also purchase not only the new book, but a little companion booklet that compares everything, every section in here that changed from one edition to another. And we use that, but you know, we also don't want to just assume that we want to stick with everything that's being carried forward. You know,
right.
So we do review everything, but a good portion of our review focuses on that companion publication. Yep.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Carl.
Yeah, thank you. Chad, so if I'm sure I understand this right, what's the consequence if we do nothing, if we don't approve a new code? And the state goes, they approve, say, the 2009 code, and we don't. And so do we have to meet that standard or not? What happens if we don't?
Well, I'm not aware of a precedent, I guess.
Okay.
I suppose if we don't adopt, and I suppose a worst case or a possible problem that could arise, if we enforce off of a code that may be current for the city standards,
mm-hmm.
but it is not, it doesn't match what the state requires, I suppose that developer, building owner, contractor could make a claim that we're illegally enforcing code that,
okay.
or we're enforcing code that doesn't legally apply.
Okay.
And so I don't know the extent of the ramifications there or how that would play
okay.
out.
I remember in the back, last time we did this, I think, seems to me probably the most contentious issue, as I recall, had to do with efficiencies of furnaces.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Ring a bell?
I was not here, but I have heard the explanation of some of those discussions that went on.
Okay.
We have the current batch of codes that will be going here in a week or two does not include that. That would be in the mechanical code. The mechanical code task force has completed its recommendations. We are currently looking at
all of that information, putting it, compiling it, putting it into this format to be able to, one, review on our own, and then it'll then get, you know, we'll brief the mayor on any of that stuff that we feel is important, and then move it on to the code study committee process. So we haven't hit that one yet.
Okay. I just was going to ask you about, you outlined the process. I was curious as to where we are in that.
We are, okay, for, let me see if I can get us to the right spot here. That was just that. So we have four or five codes right now that are ready to go for adoption. They've been through both of the public process, task force, code study. Law department has drafted the ordinances, putting the final touches on one or two of them, and they're actually going to be on a first reading for the 28th. And that'll be the fire code, property maintenance code, commercial building code, residential building code, electrical code. Did I say that yet? I think that's the five.
Okay.
They will come to, they will be first reading on the 28th and then public hearing on the 4th or the 5th, whatever that is. And then plumbing and mechanical would be the final codes. Those will be adopted, or those will hopefully complete the code study committee process within the next month or so. And if we can beat the Christmas vacation rush, try and get those in before that. If not, it'll be early next year.
Right. That was kind of a follow-up question to what Carl was asking about. What's the total timeline involved in this whole thing, from start to finish?
Sometimes, like it can, I think. Let me answer you in the way that I envision it moving forward from now. We had during the tab between the task force and the code study committee, there was a number of process changes going on because it was kind of a, I don't want to, unregulated comes to mind, but that's not the right word, but the process wasn't real formal. It wasn't real formalized. And so in conjunction with law department and we kind of came up with a couple of process changes to get more communication and a more formalized recording of these changes and these decisions that some of these groups were making seemingly on their own, and just kind of formalizing that to be more, I don't know if transparent is the right word, but just a more formal version. So I anticipate, depending upon the severity of the changes or the amount of changes from code to code, like I said, our internal review will probably last a couple of months. Task force review, or you know, getting that together and then scheduling the task force, getting everybody's schedules and commitment, it has taken anywhere from 2 months to 8 months. This last electrical review took somewhere along six, seven months to get done. So that's almost a year right there with that review. And then from there, there's not a ton left. We get it all compiled, all down, because to that point, everything has been dealt with the weeds, word for word reviews, you know, bringing in outside people. So to get to code study committee, I would say a couple of more months would be the longest extent possible. So probably anywhere from a year to 15 months from the start of the review to adoption would be my goal.
Okay. I would just say one thing that I liked the idea when you talked about how there's also a booklet you can get that shows all the changes mm-hmm. from one code version to the next code version. And it would, for my mind, it would be useful, at least to me, if we saw something similar come forward when you bring it to the council
sure.
to say, this is what it was, this is what it is, these are the changes, and these are the implications of the changes.
Sure.
Because sooner or later, somebody's going to ask about it, and it would be good if we knew.
And I actually toyed around with gearing this presentation a little bit more in that direction, some more detailed code change items. I started looking at that, and we have a ton of changes that goes in, most of which are very, very minor. Changing of section numbers, changing of definitions or adding definitions for clarification or harmonizing type language between the different codes. And so I would envision being able to do something like that if we're okay with maybe it's an overall summary of the if there are major changes. This round there really was no major changes. The most probably one of the most eye-opening ones or the most interested ones would have been Sky Lanterns. We had actually, in our code, voted to outlaw Sky Lanterns back with the task force process, but that kind of already happened publicly, so that's probably not going to generate a lot of excitement. Now, if... or maybe it will. but we certainly can do something like that. It'd be, depending upon the year, it could be a very long discussion and the number of changes. But otherwise, the other thing that we could do is just provide you with a document to read, you know, go through at your leisure and then come up with specific.
Part of my problem is, you know, this is a whole new area of interest for me that I have never explored before the last couple of years. And so I could look at that list of things and not have any clue what was really be of concern to somebody who's a builder out in the community. And so it would be helpful if somebody from the staff could say, hey, these are the things that were causing some either concern or that will result in a change in how we do business in the city of Lincoln.
Sure.
And that kind of information would be helpful.
Sure. And I'll take that back and just, I'll see if what has maybe been requested of staff in the past. There may be, I mean, people have been there for a long time, so there may be good examples of how they conducted that.
I'm not real familiar with the property maintenance code, but I am curious if it has any impact on things like problem properties or things that we get approached about all the time.
It does. There are, I'll go to that. This is one of the codes, and I started to highlight some of the items. In some of these other codes, I did put on there some of the higher profile changes. The property maintenance code, that's the group that licenses apartments. They also receive the housing complaints, mostly to do with rental properties. They also investigate illegal home businesses, that sort of thing. Problem properties, properties that end up on the problem property list, oftentimes originate from this section. They have, they're the ones that red tag properties, and so those red tag properties then end up on the PRT list. This section also administers the neglected building registry that you all approved last November. We've been working.
Is there anything about the code itself that's changing that will help with addressing problem properties more than just the neglected ordinance?
There was not a lot of change. I mean, we have the authority to, you know, do the red tag and send violations, but we don't have. We internally don't have citation authority or we don't have any additional tools to force compliance. I guess if that's kind of where you're going with that question, we don't have any additional tools with this code that give us a larger hammer to force compliance. We still have, I mean, we can still go through the legal process, get in, get the authority to force a cleanup and assess it back to the properties, but we don't have any additional tools to force somebody who's choosing not to upkeep their property very well. I will say in regard to that, the neglected building ordinance, I feel, has generated some success in that regard. We have We've had three, it's either three or four properties that have been demolished, or either by the city or by the property owner in order to get it taken off the registry. We've had another two or three, maybe even as many as four properties change ownership to somebody who wants to, who at least at this point says they want to do something with the property. So we have seen some success in that regard. So that's probably where you're looking for there. And as far as some of the changes, you had asked some of the changes here. As an example of some of the things that change from adoption to adoption, they added a date range that the property owners are required to provide heat in the dwelling, October to April. Added a section to comply with the electrical code. That's adding those little receptacle buttons, the GFCI ground fault circuit indicator. Those little plugins with the push buttons in the bathrooms. Little things like that add. And those type of things will add cost, but they're all safety related requirements. And there is a date on those. There's also one of the items that might generate some interest is the third one here. We're removing the exception for smoke alarms in existing residential occupancies to not require them in existing units. And so now a smoke alarm will be required in every unit, either in the sleeping room itself or just outside in a common hallway there. So those are examples. I think there's another one. Oh, fire code. There is one in the fire code that may generate some discussion. It is, they're also removing removing an exception for sprinkler requirements. It sounds like it would be a big cost, because now, or previously, as the code exists today, if you have a building eight or fewer units, you don't need to put sprinklers in it. However, if you read on, it has to meet three additional requirements in order to not put sprinklers in. And I think they basically have to fire rate a bunch of walls, and it basically became a wash as far as cost to provide the sprinklers or meet those three requirements. So the task force decided to let's just get rid of the exception, and because nobody meets the exception. But when you just read the code, it reads like now all of a sudden we're requiring sprinklers for those buildings, where in practicality that's the way it would have been enforced previously. The electrical code, I do need to point out one thing with the electrical code that's changing. We are switching our fee structure, and it's a good thing in a couple of ways. We're no longer going to be pricing our electrical permits on a per fixture basis. If you've ever had to take out an electrical permit, you have to check off five outlets here, a light fixture here. You have to count all those fixtures. Then our guys have to go out into the field and count how many fixtures you actually did install in the house. If that doesn't meet the permit numbers, then we have to charge. We have to do charge an additional amount or whatever. We are changing that to a per branch circuit pricing model. I didn't know what that meant until we started going through it. And basically, instead of every individual circuit or every individual fixture, outlet, light fixture, whatever, it's going to be based off of how many circuits come out of the breaker box. And there was a lot of analysis that went into this. And the short version of it is it's going to represent probably an overall cost savings to across everybody, all of our customers. The people that will see the biggest savings will be new home construction. It'll go down if the analysis is correct, anywhere from the permit fee will go down anywhere from 10% to 15% for new construction on homes. Commercial structures, large buildings, or new construction commercial, it's essentially a wash from the analysis. It's going to be a net neutral. The areas that will go up will be like residential remodel or additions. And that was a concern going in that we were going to have a category that does increase cost. However, basically what it does, it kind of normalizes the relationship between the cost to the department to administer those permits versus what they were paying. They were pretty much being subsidized by new construction and commercial. So it kind of equals out. But we think overall, across all three categories, there's going to be a net decrease in electrical permit cost to folks. Building code, like I said, we did the sprinkler change in there to match the fire code. Bunch of other small changes. The big items were going to be the some of the energy items, but those got voted out. And a bunch of other small items. We can certainly get into more details with those at a request, especially if you have an individual interest in a piece of the code. And then one other thing here. Okay, this is a did you know. Building codes date back 4,000 years, and the earliest known version was that was found published was a Hammurabi, the founder of the Babylonian Empire. And you probably can't read that, but
prince too small.
Prince extremely small. So the first little part is the fee structure. It says if a builder build a house for man and complete it, that man shall pay 2 shekels of silver for the home for his wage. The bulk of the rest is penalties. And I'll just read the first one because it gets kind of bad after that. But if a builder build a house for a man and his work is not strong, if the house that is built falls and kills the householder, that builder shall be slain. So
it gets worse from there.
It gets worse from there, involving kids and other stuff. So yeah, but
we have eased up.
I don't think people should complain about a reinspection fee or other items.
Very nice. Good item.
Yes. So
questions about that?
That's our process.
Okay.
Wow. Well, that was entertaining. Other questions?
Tough to make this entertaining.
Yes, it is. I thought about leading with that, but and I was like, no, it's going to be painful.
Should have opened with that.
Yeah. Thank you.
Great. Well, thanks for making me laugh, Chad.
Sure.
All right, we'll adjourn and regroup together with the directors and organizational meeting in a few minutes.
Okay.